Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the October 3rd, 2017 pre-agenda meeting of Burke County Board of Commissioners. All commissioners are present, along with the county manager. Remind you this time, please silence your mobile devices. Cell phones, they never contract with this one regular record. Take care of those around you. We appreciate it. If you have things to present to the board today, if you will, please come to the table. Also, we can hear you and there are various audiences can also hear you as well. All right, gentlemen, you've had an agenda for today. I would entertain a motion at this time to give the agenda to the board. If one of our votes fails, say aye. Presentations, item number one is Robert Extension, Burke County Board of Commissioners.
Thank you for letting us come. I actually am going to let Nikki Carpenter, our 4-H Development, give you the Burke County 4-H update, but just wanted to say happy National 4-H Week is this week. So thank you for your attendance this week. Been presented a flyer down for the in the past, which is very simple. Wide range statistics for this year, when it comes to one person, which the RPS and what we are doing have begun this past year and right now we are still from 4-H. So, I hope to bring at least one 4-H to the to bring over some of this around. But basically, we've got 8 active clubs right now, and they range from concert clubs to horse clubs. We also started 2 new clubs, one which is going to be the Rope Archers, another one's archery, and then we're also going to be doing a skip, which will focus on our group science and technology. The large picture you see on the front are some of our attendees from Burke County that were recognized in NC State this summer. And talks about their accomplishments. And we've had a couple livestock studies recently where we've had lots of winners. And so I posted some from the pictures that we made before show. We had a livestock show through the Government Ladies Association over at Burke County Fairgrounds just a week or two ago. We had a great time out there. Lots of animals, so they were excited. And that's kind of what we're doing. We're using different things.
So, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Any questions? We'll take them at this time. We are going to look forward to your report that day and our welcome. All right, thank you, Scott. Thank you for the Development of the South American Plant Association, Clydesdale, Pink Plant, the Woods and Fox, and Corpus State Clinic. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Honorable Commissioners. As always, I'm happy to be here with you. This is actually our 3rd award in the last 2 years for the fair work that we've been doing. The first one was a state award, and that State American Planning Association award was for a planning. We're working together with other entities together on the plan. Then the 2nd award we got, remember I traveled up to Washington, and that was a national award. That national award was for working together with public and private individuals to access public lands. And this is the award that I actually was most proud of, and that's because this award is the Martin Collins Award with the American Planning Association, and it's for the Montour State Trail Lake James section plan, but it's for implementation. So there's a ton of plans that get awards for the state plans, but this one is for actually taking a plan and putting it on the ground. And in this category, we're actually up against Charlotte, Greensboro, and Asheville, and Raleigh. For some reason, we were lumped into the largest community award program. And I went to receive this last week. I actually sat with the Charlotte Coalition that was there to receive the 40-hour program. The Fall Spring Friends, I was there as a rural county receiving the Large Community Implementation Award. It worked out nicely. So there's a lot of help, of course, from many individuals, and it continues as we build. Thank you, John. We look forward to hearing more about this. All right, friends. Item number three on presentation tools for Development Start. 2017 Community Update from our director, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, would you like me to go through each slide that you guys have, or speak to some of the highlights that matter in the interest of time?
We had an opportunity to put in the information. I guess give us some highlights.
Okay.
Any questions for the address?
We'll do that. So, one of the things is, this is from 2016, so we get our reports from the state in 2017 for the previous fiscal year. So, in 2016, we had a 4.8% visitor spending increase for a total annual economic impact of $98.48 billion. We're approaching $100 million of visitor spending in Burke County in the fiscal year. And if we grow even 2% this year, 2017, we will have already surpassed $100 million this year in visitor spending in Burke County. So we'll get that report again. That will be next August when the report comes out. But in 2016, our occupancy tax revenue increased 19.4% over the previous fiscal year. And we've also had 3,349 visitors in Burke County. One of the things I would like to highlight if we run through some of these slides and we'll take a look is that we entered some of our marketing campaign into the North Carolina Destination Marketing Awards, and we came out with a platinum award for our billboard, one of our billboards, which is up on Interstate 40, that says, "We know more than Siri, Visitor Center 8105. It's a tongue-in-cheek look at information highway and how people use their phones and social media and ask Siri to request an open summit. So we actually, that award was presented a few weeks ago, and we did out 200 other North Carolina destinations to that marketing award. We also won an award, a platinum award, for the public relations campaign on Drive Into the Paranormal at Deer's Mountains. And this was an article that was in USA Today. That was back in October of last year. And we hosted that travel writer, John Borson from Charlotte, who writes for USA Today. And he came up and wrote that. Made it to the national edition of USA Today. So our media tours continue to be the most popular, most effective means of marketing that we do. And we invite travel writers to come. In this past year of June, we actually toured the History Museum of Burke County. We went to Wiseman Cube and also also Drexel Barbershop. I'll tell you, I was totally stunned that Saturday afternoon at Drexel Barbershop, because there were people there all over the world. And Drexel Barbershop is now on social media, including Facebook, almost every day. And it is attracting visitors from far and wide to come play the standard position of visitors to come. Also, from our media tours, we had a full-page article in Carolina Country magazine, which is North Carolina's largest circulation publication, to REA. Jeff, talk a little bit about that. And that was a fantastic article in March about nature's playground here in Burke County. And that also came to media tour. Columbia County, Georgia, ran a multi-page, seven-page article in Burke County. In their June edition, talking about handwriting goodies and Appalachian goodies. And then in the September-October issue of AAA Go magazine, we were in that feature with multiple pages on Burke County, and again, thanks to that media tour. 1.9 million people saw that article in Burke County, and a significant part of that article was talking about our fall color tours and our trolley. and our phone has grown from all up and down the eastern coast, not just North Carolina, South Carolina, but Virginia, looking forward on our drawing. We were going to have three times as many tours this year as we did last year, and I've been taking phone calls all morning about that. And then finally, we were in our state in March of 2017 with a color spread on a photo of Hawksville and Table Rock Mountain. And I think people like to measure how successful we are and how much our state covers. We've got a lot of coverage in the past couple of years. So I'll take any questions. We've had a great year. I think there's going to be the next few years. You're going to see explosive growth in the hospitality industry for kids. School of Science and Math is going to bring a lot of attention here. Already has created business for us in our restaurants and our hotels. We'll continue to push them.
Thanks, Ed. Also, working with
there's another piece there, yeah, but you're right. September.
There's a little insert in our state on 10 different topics of time.
Yeah, the Mountain Tour, Mountain Fall, whatever.
Yeah. You could handle the schedule for the period this month, so play the song for Alphabet and send it to the first out of his BDX, CD Pop Solutions. So if you'll see it,
I'd like to provide a recap of the Steve Foam Solutions grant. Steve Foam Solutions located in the town of Valdez in Burke County in 2014. And during that time, they were provided a one seat grant to the Department of Commerce, which required a dollar for dollar match. And of that, $20,000 to $10,000 was approved by the Board of Commissioners as well as the John Valley in 2014. None of those funds had been distributed to the company at the time. They were still trying to create the jobs they were required for the grant. And at this time, they have done that. The state has provided them the $20,000 for the grant. We would be asking is that the $10,000, which would go to the town of Valdez, for the agreement, come out of the down fund. Seed funds is required to hire 40 employees, and at this time, they have created over 40 jobs.
Were they late hoping to accomplish that resolution we missed it? We just met that every night.
At the time that we were asked about potential economic development grants, that did not feel that they were going to meet the requirements, but they had not met all of the eligible items that was required, and so just did not think that that was going to happen.
Well, if we want to do it, here's the question. We're in compliance with building at this point.
Correct. The grant agreement just ended September 3rd of this year. All the documentation was sent to the Department of Commerce, where they did review all the relevant requirements that they did meet the I do not. Of course, they have to meet the county's average wage, so I know that page for a moment. I think we're also that grant will get there. Do you also have to pay for insurance for the grant?
Thank you.
years told us they were having scholarship and they do these simple protocols. The county currently uses fuel man as for the off-site gasoline purchases. But the finance department believes switching to REX would be very advantageous. REX is the sole vendor in the state of North Carolina fuel card contract. REX fuel cards are accepted at more locations, and this program includes a 440 functions, which is a useful tool for tracking usage and spending in the county. And pay returns with this program are ended by 3:30. Also offers an additional rebate for independents. By switching to X, the county will receive a 1.6% monthly rebate on fuel purchases throughout the state.
All right, that's a question. Mr. Chairman, this program, but this is what we
server and citizen participation program, which just makes sure that we get calculated or calculated for it, and say, we got a list of what's going on.
Any questions for the administrator? Mr. Chairman, we have a woman in town, check on the page, and I know we're not grabbing any food, so. I've kind of jumped off the page on page 62 on the top line. And it refers to two different times, so a list of the jobs, contracts, and supplies. The word supply is kind of not known, and refers to according to what a friend told me that most of the time it includes.
Reading them before, I have not seen them.
Oh, you wouldn't have to do that. So that makes sense.
I'm here today to simply just ask that November be the claims as National Hospice Month. I'm here in Burke County, it is National Hospice Month across the nation in November, and we use that month as an opportunity to encourage citizens to learn more about hospice and care. Any questions for Ann on this month?
Thank you.
that we're just asking you to make her see a signal of what to instead of the big tent for that offer. We've actually put out for the super service just kind of in the front of the company. First off, I think that is the tax collection agreement with the tax rule grant. This is just a standard agreement that we've done with the board and you supporting this chapter so far. There is a couple of things in here that has asked for a couple of technical measures. It is something that I didn't have asked this week. Go back to the county system. We collect for them. Now, in the cases in this foundation that we collect for them, then what we do is, you know, advertise for about 6 points as well. We get a quick look at this coverage, Delta County, and the municipalities. So it's really well done, Delta County, along with the county, and all the Caribbean coverage. It'll have all those in this first paragraph of the top. And then, what we did for cities, we collected from Justin County, and the fire district did not say $100, but because we did collect the top program also, it was going to say $120. If that's not breaking out, it's the most pay on what's done, what's fire district. It's just one type for that one person. So how do we do that? EMS collections at this point in time, we've collected almost $500,000, which is a 15%. If you look at this one, it's a little bit different than the last couple that you were seeing. what we've got is two or three or four pieces out of the basis. I don't think that we've reported about the respect of 1,150 revenue. Of that, we've got $15,102 in central expense revenue, which gives us over. We have a base rate of $19,049 in revenue savings. And of that, local basis, the amount of $1,000 in revenue I will make one more thing on the next single, sort of a large number that I mentioned. This is that it's one of the public utilities that one of the public utilities to this report that we go from that form to the list of fibers and fibers. When our system works, we have to replace the entire building. Yeah.
originally told that the monument is based on that individual inscriptions where individuals that came up with the government wanted included on one of the four marble plaques on the monument. Evidently, that was sufficient to take it across, but it wasn't sufficient to take it across. The county has on January 1st, 2008, entered into an agreement, a lease agreement, with the city of Morgan, whereby the county agreed the rest of the courthouse road to the city of Morgan to the city for a term of 25 years. There's also a dual provision that says that the city of the city's discretion can extend that lease for completion of the for a period of up to 40 years from January 1st, 2008. The city is the lessee of the entire property. In the lease, the city is responsible for properly maintaining in a good state of repair both the existing Confederate soldier monument and the Confederate Murphy statue. The city is required to ensure these statues at their full conservative value. And the city has the right to install other artwork monument statues on the courthouse grounds at its discretion. So, as the city leases the entire courthouse ground that they're going to prompt the government, they would with it those fixtures, such as the monument. So, based upon the lease, it's my opinion that either the county or the city have the right to do anything concerning monuments without the consent of the other party. Because the county has leased it, they can't do anything without getting the consent of the lessee, because it's one of the things that leases. The lessee has a difference in the duties and maintenance, and can't risk it on two statutes without the consent of the county to do the work. So, in this situation, just by the terms of the lease, it would take both the consent of the county and the consent of the city in order to make the consent. But all of that is in here in the case, because in 2015, the legislature passed a law called the Monument Protection Act, which has been codified as NCPA Section 100-2.1. And that statute involves objects of remembrance, objects of remembrance that is located on public property. And object of remembrance is first of all defined as a monument, memorial, plaque, statue, marker, or display of a permanent character that commemorates an event, a person, a military service that is part of North Carolina's history. So, the Confederate monument is then installed under that as an object of remembrance. The law goes on to provide that an object of remembrance located on public property should not be permanently removed and may only be relocated whether temporarily or permanently under the circumstances listed in this statute and subject to the limitation. There are only two circumstances that would allow permanent removal of an object of remembrance, and that would be to is over the office, or when it is necessary for construction, innovation, or reconfiguration of buildings, open spaces, parking, or transportation projects. If an object of remembrance is removed, it will be located anchored at either of those sections. The object of remembrance has to be relocated to a site of similar prominence, honor, visibility, availability, and access within the boundaries of the jurisdiction in which it is related. The site goes on to say that an object of remembrance may not be relocated to a museum, cemetery, or mausoleum unless it is originally placed at such a location. So I think by this, the legislature has taken over the determination of when a monument can be removed and for what reason. The only exception is that would be applicable to us would be if the object of remembrance poses a threat of public safety because of unsafe.
I think it's a mistake. It has to be a mistake. I appreciate the overview of
They are worthy of the troubles of freedom following the most scenario.
Well, I think that the troubles of freedom would be an object of remembrance. Once they've already done it, they all do it.
Thank you.